Well, good afternoon and welcome to our DMACC Career Discovery event. We are excited to have a social worker here with us today for our Ask a Professional session. We have Rose Klingbeil here with us, and I will speak a little bit more about her, and we'll learn more about her journey as a social worker here in just a second. But we are excited to have you guys here with us. We want you to engage with Rose today, so please ask any questions. She is, you know, a professional in social work, so any questions for her? I know some of you are interested in that career path, so please engage with her. Feel free to leave them in the comments, or of course, you can always unmute yourself. Before we get started, I'd like to say hello. My name is Jill Hoik, and I have Amy Stainhook here with us, and she is my colleague. We both work in the work-based learning department at DMACC. So thank you for being here to the participants, and a huge thank you to Rose for your time today to speak with us. So now just a little bit more about Rose Klingbeil. So she is a social worker for the Des Moines Public Schools. I don't think she's always worked in a school, so we're kind of learn a little bit more about that. But again, students, engage with her, ask any questions, but I'll kind of kick it off. Rose, I know that you work, as a school social worker now, but can you kind of go way back and think about kind of what led you on this journey? Were you a little girl knowing you wanted to go into a profession like this, or is this something that came to you later? And just kind of how you got to where you are today.
So if I go back probably a little bit further, when I was in high school, I was interested in being an accountant. I liked math, so I took some accounting classes when I was in high school, and I can remember I have a sister that's 3 years older than I am, and when I took them, she was like, you can't be an accountant, like, you need to do something that helps people. Not to say that accountants can't help people, but that was her constructive criticism. So I actually had decided that speech and language pathology sounded really interesting and did a senior project in that, and I went to UNI. With the intention that I started off majoring in that. And after my freshman year, I thought, well, I think lisps are kind of cute. So I'm not really sure that this is the profession for me. And I kind of feel like I stumbled into social work. My best friend was majoring in social work. And so I kind of talked with her about what was involved in the program and the profession, and just was really drawn to helping people. Like, as generic and basic as that sounds, that's probably what brought me to social work, is just the drive to help people. I've been really fortunate to have a pretty blessed life, and I really truly have just wanted other people to have the access to the kind of opportunities and life experience that I have had. And so that is what started my journey.
Awesome. And then can you just talk a little bit about your education? I know you said you went to UNI, but specifically what your degrees are in. And of course, I know you have a master's degree as well, and just kind of speak a little bit about that and what schooling students would need in order to have a profession in social work.
Yes. So I went straight to UNI after graduating high school. And if I were to tell you now, starting out with something with DMACC is probably the smartest thing you can do, regardless of your profession, but especially when you're looking at something like social work, I've got to be honest, you don't get into it because of the money. So to have a really good base, especially with it sounds like a really cool opportunity at DMACC specifically to learn about social work and get a really good foundation in the, like, in the field, in retrospect, that's awesome. I wish I would have started with that. But yeah, I did get my bachelor's degree in social work at UNI. And so what I describe social work, especially in the bachelor's level, is kind of just a merge of all of the social sciences. So you get sociology, you get psychology, you got a lot of human theory. I took a criminology class, just kind of like, and those are all majors in themselves. And I kind of always use it as like a little bit more generalist and kind of like just all about humans and all of the aspects of humans. And I think probably it was a little bit of what they taught us at UNI was that, like, social work versus some of those other professions, you also get a few more of the hands-on tools that you would need when you're actually in the profession to do the work. So I graduated with my bachelor's from UNI, and then I went and worked for a couple of years because I was kind of, again, given the advice that to get a job with a master's degree, which is where I knew I wanted to end up because there were some more opportunities at that level, I needed to have some experience to go behind the education. So after graduating, I worked for Lutheran Services in Iowa, who's a really big social service provider and provides a whole like array of services in the state of Iowa. And I actually did what was called the HOPES program. And I worked in early childhood. I worked with families that were pregnant through age 5 and provided them like in-home support on development, on engagement, on health, all of those sorts of things. And aside from my, I want to help people, that was really my background. And I had done some work, actually, even when I was at UNI, I worked in the social services as my part-time job as well, which I guess is a part of my story. So that's where I started off of. And really what I have found like in my different parts of social work, even with my master's degree, is that kind of the basic principles of social work apply no matter what job you're in, even though they might be vastly different. Like I could learn about the development, prenatal development and early childhood development. But what I learned through my social work education and probably just is a part of who I am is like the empathy and active listening and good communication and those skills that are pretty universal no matter what your job title may be.
Yes, thank you for that background. Rose, like I was telling you before, I was sitting in with the sessions of our instructors and professors of our program at DMACC, and they kind of consider themselves as superheroes in real life. And I just really liked that, the way that they kind of talked about it. So would you say that, you said that you right out of your bachelor's degree in social work, that you did start working. Would you say that most commonly you will need to have a master's degree at some point, or is that not always necessary?
It depends on what you want to do. And once you're kind of in, like I learned about kind of what the different opportunities were in social work in my undergraduate. So that was helpful to kind of tell me what I wanted to do. And so there are a lot of opportunities, and they're not always called social work, but there are a lot of opportunities in the field of social work, I think, even with just a high school diploma. And then there are more opportunities that kind of open up when you have an associate's degree and when you have a bachelor's degree and when you have a master's degree. And so I think it really depends on like what your passion is and what you would like to do. For me, I knew that I was interested in school social work. Probably my mom was a teacher. And so I think I was really exposed to that realm growing up. And funny enough, I was like, I'm not ever going to be a teacher. And then I end up working for a school system. So it's kind of ironic in that way. And to be a school social worker, like in the role that I have now, I have to have a master's degree. Although there are other positions, like even in Des Moines public schools that might not call themselves social worker, but really do social work that don't need your bachelor's degree. It just opens up, I think the more education you have, the more doors you have open. And like practically speaking, the more education you have, like the more money that you can make doing it. And I think that has to be a consideration to be practical and say like, can I make a living wage? Can I support my family in those questions? And so that was all part of what went into my consideration and my decision.
Absolutely. And I think that it's really great, when you do go to college and you are exposed to different avenues, that's kind of what helps you figure it all out. And then you could be like, okay, this is the avenue. So potentially I would need to go on and get a master's degree. So that's really great to know that, when you are kind of going through school, you don't necessarily have to have it all figured out at that moment. Just kind of more about what you're interested in.
Yeah. And okay. Social work is a very, very broad field.
Yeah.
And there are sometimes people come to me with questions and I'm like, I don't know. I know that that's social work, but it's not a area of social work I have any expertise in. So that can be frustrating, but it's also awesome in terms of career potential is that there it is very, very, very broad.
Yes. Well, now kind of on to like a fun question. What would you say is one of the biggest wins of your career? And I know that you're probably like, oh my gosh, I have so many, or every day there's a win. But if you could just think back to maybe one or two times that you really felt fulfilled in what you do.
Yeah, I think I thought about that when I saw it, when you sent me the possible questions. I thought, because I think at least for me, one of my social work like core values is being strengths-based. And sometimes people might call me a little bit too like cheery and a little bit too good at like reframing things that might not be positive into being positive. So they probably think I feel victory every day, because you really do have to take the small things sometimes. But I was thinking about it, and one of my most recent kind of satisfying moments for me is, this is my fourth year working as a school social worker. And actually just last week, there's a student that is in one of the programs I serve, and he invited me to his high school graduation. Aww. And it was just like a super heartwarming moment. Like, oh my gosh, like one, you're going to graduate. And I've been part of that team to help you be successful in doing that. And there have been some really good team meetings with like all of his providers and all of his supports to get him to that place. But two, that like he feels connected enough to me that he wants me to come to his graduation party, because I'm not a classroom teacher. Like, I have less interaction, you know, than the folks in the classroom do with students. So it was a pretty heartwarming and kind of a little big victory that I've had recently.
Yeah. And speaking kind of about, you know, a little bit about your personality traits, when I was in the session with our instructors last week, a student asked about, she was wondering if she really feels all the feelings, and she thought that this was a great profession for her, one of the students. And she's like, I, what if I cry if I'm helping someone? Is that normal? Is that okay? And we were just kind of discussing that, of course, a part of your training, you know, you learn how to handle those situations the more that you're in them, but that it is okay to feel, you know, to some point. Can you speak to that as far as feeling the emotions, but yet being that professional in that role, but also making that connections that you do every single day with students?
Yeah, I think that is probably like an art. I don't know. It's something I think that you figure out how to manage and how to develop over time. Prior to coming to this school, I was a supervisor at Orchard Place, and I supervised therapists, and a lot of them were like brand new out of their master's programs. And so a lot of my discussions with them revolved around, like, not necessarily, you know, crying while they're working with somebody, but managing your emotions, your self-care, because in our profession, you take on a lot of other people's stuff. You hear a lot of other stuff and you help them through it, but you're human. So you're still going to feel some of it. And I think that empathy, that ability to kind of relate and feel with the people is important. I think that's what makes the genuine connection with people, is that you care. But I also think that having those professional boundaries are important. And I don't know what the exact piece of it, what makes it click, but I think that as you kind of get out there and you have some good support from supervisors yourself, they can kind of help you figure out, how do you manage this? How do you react to that? Because most people getting into social work, they care a lot. They have lots of emotions and lots of feeling, and that's why they're drawn to the profession. But there certainly is that boundary, and just that like mental health for yourself, you know, and making sure that you're not feeling everything the same as the other people are feeling. That leads to burnout. And so it's figuring out what that mix is for you. And I do think training and good supervision and support are what help you develop those skills.
Yeah, that's great. And for you as a school social worker, I mean, you see these students and you know, every day, and then leaving on the weekends or even in the evenings, I'm sure that there's times that you go home and you think about them until you go to bed. And how to be able to kind of turn that on and off is probably something, like you said, that you just kind of learn. And it is an art, you know, to be able to kind of balance that work-life balance and try to shut it off when you can, and that type of thing. So with that, you kind of touched on it, but as far as personality traits or what things you feel that students going into this profession, what are some top ones that you can think of that they would really need to have?
I think empathy is a huge one. And I think if you haven't watched it, you should watch this just short little clip by Brené Brown that's Sympathy versus Empathy. And it's awesome. It does a great job of explaining the difference between the two. But I think the ability to like recognize and say, you're not okay, but you'll, you know, like, how can I help you? And that sort of approach. So I think the ability to have that and be supportive. And I think being a good communicator. And that includes both being able to listen, but also able to verbalize and kind of reflect back what other people are feeling. I think you also have to be pretty good at problem solving and thinking on your feet, because a lot of things get thrown at you, expected or unexpected, and being flexible with that. It's a pivot. It's always a pivot to figure out, you know, what's going on and what you can do.
Yeah, that's awesome. What do you find are the biggest challenges of your career, would you say?
I think, well, I said, like, I'm a very glass half full kind of person, but in like the social work profession in general, I feel it a little bit less in my school social work position than I did when I was a therapist, but it's still present. And I think it's always present in every aspect, is that you deal with a lot of other people's hurt. You deal with a lot of other people's kind of what other people might think of as like negative feelings and experiences and emotions and sadness, you know, and you hear sad stories, you see sad stories, and that is hard. That is hard. And I think that's why it comes back to that self-care and trying to figure out, how do I manage those things? And how do I have that boundary to recognize, like, this is what I can do and this is what I can't do. Because that is a hard thing to realize. And to people starting new, I know it sounds really kind of pessimistic, but you have to establish those things. Again, otherwise you're going to burn out pretty quickly, because there's only so much that you can do. You can do a lot and you can do amazing things, but being able to have a good frame, you know, and a good view and outlook of what you can do. And also to celebrate the small victories, because it can feel really hard and it can feel really defeating at sometimes, because it's a lot of heavy stuff you're dealing with all the time. So I think that's why I end up like overcompensating sometimes with positivity, which might be to my detriment in all honesty at times, but it is like, I gotta find it. And it feels good. It feels good to celebrate small victories, because even like for the students or the clients you may serve, like, they often overlook the fact that they've made progress because it's not what their end goal is. But like, looking at what are those little steps, what are the things they have done, and focusing on those.
Yeah. And I think that that's important, you know, to them, they may not feel like they're making any progress, but you're like, look at what you've all done, and just showing them the progress that they've made and being positive, it just goes a long way. So yes, thank you for that. Well, this is probably a question you're going to giggle at too. Can you walk me through what a typical day would be like in your shoes? And I know it's like every day you kind of roll with the punches, and it's probably not the same. You probably haven't had 2 days the same since you've became a school social worker, but can you just kind of walk me through what a day kind of looks like in your shoes?
Yeah. So one thing we haven't talked about that's a big part of social work is paperwork. There's a lot of documentation you have to do no matter what part of the profession that you do. And so a lot of my day, honestly, is doing paperwork. Like right now, I work a lot with students with disabilities and working on IEPs and working on plans. And so that's definitely a piece of it. And some of the paperwork might just be, you know, responding to emails, because they're just kind of coming back and forth all day and you're managing that and you're trying to figure out. I might get an email like, hey, I got one yesterday, and it was an email from a teacher, and she said, you know, this student is crying in my classroom. Can you come down and talk to her? And so in between meetings, I ran down to meet with her. And honestly, those are the feel-good moments, right? Where I'm like, oh, great. Like, she's kind of wasn't in a terrible crisis. It wasn't feeling good. And I was able to kind of just sit with her and listen to what she was feeling, but also kind of help her feel better. And like, she could go back to class to learn. So yeah, paperwork and responding to emails and meetings. There are also a lot of meetings. And so that is, again, also a fun part. Not all meetings are bad. We have a lot of opportunities to collaborate. That's a huge part of social work, is collaborating with your colleagues and collaborating with people in different disciplines, because you all bring a different lens to it. So I have a lot of meetings in my day, and they come from, you know, maybe a meeting specifically about a student, with their teacher, or maybe like with their whole team to talk about what their plan is. I have meetings with teachers. I have meetings with other like professionals, maybe a student's going to be coming to our school, and those sorts of things. Honestly, like, paperwork and meetings are the staples of every day. And then what gets thrown in between is kind of a mix of whatever happens. Yeah. And I like to tour around. I am a social person, if you could believe that or not, social person majoring in social work. And so I like to check in and kind of see, you know, how teachers are doing, how students are doing, because that is kind of what fills my cup a little bit. But I also recognize that relationships are extremely important. And I wouldn't have been helpful to that student when she was crying if we didn't have that relationship already established. So that's kind of part of what my effort is. Like, it just seems like I'm fluttering and loud, like probably with nothing else to do. People may very well think that, but I have intention and I have thought behind it. Like, I need to connect. I need to be in front of these kids so that if I do need to be a person who responds to when they're struggling, that they know me and they know that they can trust me, and we have some of that relationship built already.
Can you kind of explain the difference of your role in what you do in a school compared to maybe what the guidance counselor does and their mm-hmm. role, kind of the difference when you are both working at a school, the big difference between them?
So I think that is going to depend a lot on like your grade level as well as your school district. And so what I can describe is high school and Glenn Public Schools. So know that is definitely true. And my role is actually changing right now. Typically, until midway through this year, I've been pretty exclusively working with students that have IEPs or have special education, more specifically students that have behavioral issues or behavior goals, but also looking at supporting a lot of their transition plans. So a lot of my focus has been around like the supports for their behavior and their supports for their transition plan. Versus the guidance counselor, who in high school does like a lot of the scheduling, like does all of the scheduling for students, is going to be that person that they will also talk to about their transition plans and stuff like that. But kind of as an IEP team, we have an obligation to help students with that transition plan. So we have more resources and efforts, and I'm just a part of that team that helps move that forward. And guidance counselors are more likely to get those students that might be in crisis that are struggling that day. And for a couple of reasons. One is that they essentially serve all students, and I've typically only served a small portion of students. And two is that, at least in my role, again, just unique to me, I have always been assigned to multiple schools, and so I'm not there every day. So I am not always that dependable person to go to when you're struggling. But that being said, like in Des Moines Public Schools, we're working towards an integrated services model. And so social work is a big part of that. And so my job is getting pushed out. But more like, I guess one way to look at it is too, is that like social workers or guidance counselors serve everybody. They're kind of like the base and the foundation. And I'm probably more towards the top of the pyramid in terms of like students that are struggling more significantly or have more needs. Not to say that the guidance counselor wouldn't help in that situation, or I wouldn't help if that's appropriate. We both have counseling skills, but that's probably a way to look at it too. Like they serve everybody, I serve a smaller portion of students.
No, that's great. That's a great description of that. And I want to be cognizant of time. So Jalen and Maria, if you have any questions, please ask now. Let me check the chat. Maybe I haven't done that. Oh, okay. So just to kind of wrap up here, and what advice would you give? Oh, Maria, she has a question. I got excited. Sorry. You mentioned doing therapy at one job. What is the difference between being a psychologist and a social worker? Great question.
Okay. So a psychologist, again, I'm thinking like to be a therapist, you have to have your master's degree at least. So psychologists and social workers can both do therapy. That is true in regards to therapy specifically, but psychologists, at least in my experience working at Orchard Place, do therapy, but they also tend to do more like psychological evaluations. So oftentimes, at least at Orchard Place, where I saw it being done, it's probably the only one I can really specifically talk about. They may have a group of people that are on their caseloads that they see regularly for psychology, and that's what would overlap with social work in that regard. But they would also do like a whole wide range of psychological testing. So intellectual testing in regards to different kinds of behavioral things, just kind of the myriad of like standardized tests that you can do in regards to psychological functioning. And then they write up those reports. So they're not necessarily providing like services and supports for what is identified in the reports, but they're probably providing that so that that family or that individual can get more of an idea of what services that they may need to be successful. The other thing I've kind of always said, because therapists, there's really a wide range of degrees and even licensures that can get you to therapy. I'm a licensed independent social worker in the state of Iowa, and that's what my licensure with the state is. And so I can provide therapy. But when I say like social work is very, very broad, what I like about it is that I could say, I think I want to be a therapist, but I don't know that I want to be a therapist forever. You know, I kind of want to have different options in terms of what I could do in my career. Well, social work could help me be a therapist. It could help me be a school social worker. It could help me do this. Like it really, that licensure and that degree is a broader, it's bigger. Like your schooling might not have as many like clinical classes as somebody who has a degree, maybe in psychology or in like family therapy or different things like that. But you get that training when you're on the job that kind of helps you tailor to it. And there's psychologists, there's social workers, and then there are like in the state of Iowa, licensed marriage and family therapists who may have a degree in psychology, but actually have like a master's degree in that or something really related to that, or a mental health counselor who may have a master's degree in mental health counseling. And those are wonderful and great things. And not to say that you couldn't have those and probably do some other things in the social work profession, but like none of those people with their licensures could be a school social worker. You have to have your social work master's degree to be able to do that. So I feel like it opens up more doors, but it really just depends on what you're interested in and what your passion is.
Yes. Great question, Maria. And thank you for answering that, Rose. And I think like you said, Rose, too, every kind of place and kind of calls it different things. And so you really just kind of got to know what you want to do sometimes to be able to move forward with that direction, right? I just think that there's so many options that which is great. Okay. Well, this is the last question. Make sure I didn't miss them all. Okay. What advice would you give to students, that are, you know, young, maybe still in high school that are wanting to enter this field? What could they be doing now? Just any advice you would give them?
Yeah, I think that looking like, honestly, when you think of what you want to do for your career, looking into something like starting at DMACC, I said that earlier, is just a really good idea. In retrospect, I definitely wish I would have gone that route. Because it just provides you, again, like a really big lens. And then you can narrow down once you see what's in that lens, what you might want to do from there. But I would say on top of that, you know, volunteering opportunities, if there are any options within your school, like in Des Moines Public Schools, we have something called Unified Sports. And that is a program where there are students with special needs paired with like general education students, and they do activities together, they do sports together. There's just an opportunity that's very, I mean, it's just fun, first of all, and like a good connection, but it also is an opportunity because in some ways you are kind of starting with the helping profession of doing that for other people. You know, if you're interested in working with elderly people, you know, see if you can, if there's opportunities for you to work at, you know, your like assisted living or nursing home in your area. There are social workers that work in that field. Don't be afraid to ask in your school, hey, is there somebody that I can talk to in the school that does this kind of job that I can learn more about? Come to things like this. You know, those are great opportunities to learn more about what you might like.
Yeah, that's great. Any classes you would suggest that students kind of hone in on if they have a chance to explore in high school? Obviously, probably psychology and those type of courses, but anything else you can think of off the top of your head? Like,
I would think like psychology, sociology, criminal justice, any of those kind of cluster of classes would be really helpful. It probably depends on what all you have, but I just say, yeah, in general, if you're not sure what you want to do, take a little bit of everything. Again, I took those accounting classes And I am really glad I did, because I might have gone to UNI and majored in accounting. They have a very good accounting program there. And I don't know that I would have been quite as satisfied as I am. I probably would have figured out before I got a degree. But take anything that is of interest to you. And I think, you know, you bring whatever experiences you have into the profession of social work, and it's a part of your personality and part of your style. And so I just would encourage you to explore in general what interests you.
That's awesome. Well, I will kind of start to conclude this event. Rose, you have been wonderful and awesome explaining your profession and just giving us all the knowledge. It has really been great. So thank you, Jalen and Maria, for also attending as well. But everybody have a wonderful and safe weekend. Thank you so much, Rose.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.